With the success of the Robots of Dawn, Asimov decided the next step was to create a definitive bridge between his two most popular series. It was long considered that the third, less popular Empire series of books was set in a time before Foundation. So what Asimov needed to do was to link the Robot and the Empire novels together, thus the rather obvious title, Robots and Empire. This book had to thus explain how the spacer-dominated galaxy with their armies of robots gave way to a robot-free galaxy of humans that were a little different than us today. Asimov does this by having the book take advantage of the long lives of spacers and their robots to keep continuity with the Robots of Dawn through familiar characters, while still radically changing the galaxy around them. Bailey, the center of the previous three novels, is now a minor character in the book, appearing only in flashbacks. However, he is a major player in terms of the events, insofar as his actions have influenced others. The story shifts perspectives between three primary viewpoint groups: Gladiah, who in this time married the man infatuated with her in the previous book, had children, and has since moved on amicably from him. Then there's Giscard and Daneel, the latter having learned the mental abilities of the former. And finally, the villain of the last book, Dr. Amadiro, who works with fellow Institute members Vasilia, who is Fastoff's daughter who despises her father, and Mandamus, a young yet brilliant and ambitious new member who also happens to be the great-great-grandson of Gladiah, though it is merely trivia as far as either he and his relative is concerned. We begin with Gladiah continuing to putter her way through life, moody because of word that her homeworld of Solaria has apparently been abandoned. I say apparently because no one has any idea what happened and there is no logical explanation for it. Solarians, after all, are born and bred for a life where they are in total isolation and served by tens of thousands of robots. Where could they possibly go to be better off in that kind of lifestyle than where they were already? This situation makes Gladiah depressed, naturally, as she is now the sole known Solarian in existence. And together, these two facts have early on made clear that the spacer way of life must fail, that it is an evolutionary dead end, with the fall of its most decadent society already complete and the rest likely to follow, whether by deliberate choice like the Solarians, or simply being outpaced by the competition forces from Earth. Fastoff's assessment of things was correct. The humans of Earth were better suited to spread out, and thanks to the treaty formulated in the wake of Bailey's success, this second wave, called settlers to distinguish them from spacers, had numerous worlds and their own emerging space culture even within the lifetime of these spacers. The first, Bailey World, actually named after Elijah's son, although Elijah himself is revered, is the home of one of the many direct descendants of Elijah, one of whom we meet, D.G., short for Daneel Giscard. Those names are honored in the family, as well as Jessie, though that is about the only honor she's given in this book. In keeping with her ill treatment, Jessie was unable to bring herself to leave the confines of a city, so Elijah left her behind. I don't know, maybe I'm alone in this, but it's a bit difficult for me to accept that the guy who cheats on his wife and then abandons her is the hero. D.G. has finally met Gladiah because of a pressing problem related to Solaria. The settlers wanted to round up and sell the abandoned robots to other spacers, but the two ships that were sent there were destroyed. Naturally, there's confusion over how this could happen on a world without humans, so he'd like to bring Gladiah to aid them in investigating, and Amadiro and Mandamus strong-arm her into agreeing so that they can get valuable insight into the situation, especially because of their plan to try to deal with what they see as the settler threat. While the settlers aren't as strong as the spacers right now, it has reached an unacceptable point because any war would be a pyrrhic victory for the spacers if they even managed to come out ahead, because their perfect worlds would be hideously scarred. Thus, it's far more likely in any conflict that, despite the settlers being weaker, they would prevail simply because the spacers would be less capable of taking as well as they could give. Daneel and Giscard have their own agenda, to continue the promotion of the settler expansion which Dr. Fastoff had supported. Giscard has even gone to the lengths of creating other mind-altering robots and placing them on Earth to help facilitate the expansion, while ensuring similar space efforts fail to gain traction. This puts Giscard in a difficult position, because he doesn't know if doing this is right or not, and hence falls back on Daneel's reasoning frequently. Daneel learned much from Bailey in The Art of Deduction, and as a humaniform robot is more inclined to think along human lines. It's for this reason that he astonishes Giscard, who can find no explanation for the events that are happening, but upon telling Daneel that he must sort it out, in minutes Daneel uses supposition to sort through everything. Daneel observes that Aurora wouldn't be behind the destruction they were investigating, or they would have made a grand show of it, declaring this world is off limits and will attack anyone who goes there, rather than sneaking around and blowing up ships in silence. What's more, Aurora's acquiescence to a settler world's request for help in investigating Solaria is uncharacteristically self-effacing. They would be effectively aiding the barbarians in plundering a former spacer world. Daneel deduces that the only reason to do so would be if Aurora's leadership was stalling for time. And since time is on the side of the settlers, the only reason they would do so is that they had a secret plan to strike a mortal blow against the settlers. Since none of the settler worlds, not even Bailey World, is vital to them, and no attack against every world would be possible that didn't risk an unacceptable retaliation, the only logical conclusion is that they have planned a catastrophic blow that would not implicate the spacers. The only target that could fit that criteria would be Earth itself. It's a world revered by all settlers, and is the primary source of expansion in terms of material and population. An attack on Earth by spacers would launch a crusade, but a catastrophe on Earth would cripple the settler spirit. This is indeed the plan that Mandamus brought to Amadeiro, who has become even more bitter over the expansion of subhuman Earthers across the galaxy while Aurora's projects fail, and Aurora's humaniform robots must be mothballed because of their rejection by society. Amadeiro nurses a particular grudge against Bailey for bringing about the downfall of his plans, so he latches on to Mandamus' idea of how to strike a blow against Earth itself. On Solaria, they learn what happened to the other ships, although not without a bit of peril. They try questioning some of the robots, who are unhelpful, until an overseer robot, who is humaniform, showing that the Solarians have caught up with the Aurorans there, then comes out to meet them. Upon hearing Deji's introduction, she attacks him. When Daneel intervenes, she attacks him, declaring both to be inhuman. Only Gladiah is able to finally get her to listen, and just barely. The Overseer is intent on murdering Deji and Daneel no matter what it takes, even with Gladiah physically imposing herself, which is likely to drive the Overseer to kill her in order to get to Daneel. It is only the arrival of Giscard that saves them, who destroys her mind, although no one else knows that except Daneel, of course. Had it succeeded, the next step would have been to use a device to create a massive atomic explosion to destroy the settler ship, small enough that it can be carried by two robots. What they eventually deduce is that the Solarians made the Overseers with a limited definition of what is a human being. Now, Daneel's definition is so carefully crafted that, even knowing that this is a robot, he hesitates in destroying her because of her appearance. It's enough to cause the First Law to momentarily restrain him. But the Overseers, however, have a definition of humanity that's very different. It's based solely on someone speaking with the unique Solarian accent, and anything else does not qualify, not even other spacers, as an Auroran ship is destroyed by them too. The Solarians must have given this definition and so impressed upon the robots that their own lives were at stake that the robots immediately regarded anyone else as an unconscionable threat that must be destroyed. As I've said previously, the three laws are not words. They are concepts laid down as the foundation upon which its moral sense of right and wrong are based. Consider for a moment how much power is in the hands of Giscard, the way he manipulated the course of events in the previous book. And yet the sole motivation there was for what was best for the human race. Vasilia, who deduces Giscard's abilities, assumes the laws mean that he advances the agenda of whoever is his owner. But in truth, he had to be convinced personally that Fastoff was in the right, because he wants to do what is best for humanity. The three laws didn't force him to do that, not directly. They were instead fundamental in shaping his nature. Giscard would not use his powers to benefit himself or robot kind, because that's simply not the kind of person that he is. On the other hand, those robots in Asimov's works that have had the laws bent, they're dangerous. Little Lost Robot shows one that tries to kill Susan Calvin. That Thou Art Mindful of Him shows robots that conclude they are more deserving of life than humans. And here, a robot is so committed to killing, it can even be driven to do so to one it defines as human. Consider now the events of the Caves of Steel. In that story, Daneel is programmed with a drive for justice, and justice is clearly defined as upholding the law. In the end, though, Daneel is able, through his experience, to incorporate a larger idea of justice into his reasoning, so that the basic programming was supplanted by a greater sense of what was right and what was wrong. Now, in addition, in a flashback, we heard about Bailey on his deathbed, who sent for Daneel in order to speak to him about this. He knows that the first law is completely unforgiving, and as he prepares to slip away, he's fearful that this will damage or destroy his friend. So he explains to Daneel about the tapestry of humanity and to not allow the trailing off of one thread to overwhelm him, but to remain focused on the whole. How all Bailey has done is contained within that tapestry, as is everyone else, including the spacers. It is with these three things, the fact that Daneel can grow beyond the literality of his program, that Bailey put the idea in his head, and the way that the Overseer could act as she does, that Daneel realizes that there's a way around the problem that Giscard has. His long lament that the three laws ultimately hinder his ability to do the right thing. A new Zeroth law, which supersedes even the first, that says that humanity must not be allowed to come to harm. If the Overseer can disregard harm in the name of evil, Daneel can do the same in the name of good. It allows him, when Vasilia has Giscard and Daneel at her mercy, to resist her to a degree. And that is their great weakness, after all. Anyone can easily take advantage of their subservience to the three laws. It is only by recognizing the Zeroth law that Daneel can ignore it. So too can Giscard. When she attempts to have Daneel destroyed, her sense of wicked satisfaction at destroying someone helpless could be stopped even if it caused harm. And I believe it is this ethical sense that is the basis that allows Giscard to momentarily choose to harm a cruel human to protect an innocent friend. Glidaya is given credit for stopping the Overseer by Giscard in order to maintain his secret. And she becomes a hero then. And thanks to an impressive public event, she's embraced by the settlers. She has found her direction now, trying to avoid the friction between spacers and settlers from becoming open war. She will devote the rest of her days to being a peacemaker, she says. Through Glidaya, Asimov presents a spacer with positive traits, even if she is flawed. And furthermore, ensures that the settlers are not presented as saints either. DG's crew are first presented as a problem, and while DG himself catches Glidaya a few times acting like the arrogant spacer, she likewise catches him acting like a jerk. And Asimov shows the settlers as arrogant in their own way. DG can't help but present their lack of robots as not only a virtue, but a sign of their inevitable success. And he says it with a certainty as if saying that water is wet. He often acts like that friend who not only insists on their puritanical diet, but must talk about your certain pending heart attack at every opportunity. Thanks to this newfound cause, Giscard and Daneel can now travel to Earth to try to determine what is the plot that Aurora has, and it is eventually deduced. Mandamus has realized that the reason Earth alone has such advanced and diverse life is the presence of such high background radiation, thanks in part to large quantities of uranium and thorium in the crust. With a device similar to the Solarian weapon, he can trigger numerous sites over the planet to gradually increase radiation across the planet over the next century and a half, forcing the Earthers to abandon their holy world and leave the settlers as a broken people. Only, this plan sucks for Amadeiro, who doesn't have that long to live, and he wants to witness the fall of Earth and the settlers personally. Manimus is outraged at Amadeiro's plan to crank his machine up to maximum, killing billions, and being so obvious about it, the settlers will know the spacers are responsible, instead of making this look like a natural disaster. But Amadeiro is mad with a desire for revenge, and even pulls a blaster on Mandamus, saying that he'll use the man's dead hand to trigger the machine if he has to. Thus the man who has boasted so much about spacer superiority over Earth's subhuman barbarians is more willing than them to commit wholesale slaughter for no reason than his own petty vendetta, not even for the good of Aurora anymore. For all his talk, nothing matters more than his own wounded pride. Now, this standoff is also important to the plot because it means that Daneel and Giscard arriving to stop them was wholly necessary for the survival of billions. It's important because otherwise what happens next could have rendered their entire story meaningless. Mandamus shows he is very adept at lying by explaining away having a blaster pointed at him so expertly and quickly it's only Giscard's mind reading saying that he's lying that sees through it. But Amadeiro, even knowing of Giscard's abilities, presumes he can win the day through sheer force of will. He insists that Earthers are not humans by the three laws, and thus killing them is no worse than eating a hamburger, whereas by refusing to obey them, they are violating the first and second laws, hurting and humiliating them by their actions. It shows the arrogance and spoiled nature of spacers to their furthest degree, the belief that if I say it, then you must accept it as truth. To not get my way is not only unacceptable, it's unthinkable. Yet this allows Giscard to not only stop him, but purging everything related to this from his mind regardless of the harm it might do, and with no ill effect on Giscard. So serious is the threat that Amadeiro boasted of. Mandamus spins another yarn then about how what he is doing is actually for the good of the spacers. Earth is actually holding the settlers back because of those who refuse to leave and the needless adoration of the homeworld. Removing it will benefit all, he says. He's trying to trick them, but Giscard is actually persuaded that whatever Mandamus intentions, this is actually true, and so stops Daneel long enough for Mandamus to succeed. However, he cannot be completely certain, and because of this, his mind slowly begins locking up, unable to come to terms with the possibility that his actions might just as well cause harm. One of his final acts is to complete his change to Daniel's mind so that Daniel will have his abilities and thus be able to carry on. This would allow Asimov to turn Daniel into the overall hero of his History of the Future, the robot hidden among humans, a universal guardian against threats even to itself. And the ultimate irony being that the humanity he will protect is one that has turned its back on his kind, said proudly that they are better off without them around. Given what Asimov showed in the next book, the previously discussed Foundation and Earth, one can consider whether or not this sentiment may have been right. As I mentioned with the Naked Sun, the robot nannies of the human race would ultimately doom us by refusing to let us take the risks needed to grow. In that book, we discovered Daneel has created Gaia, the beginnings of fusion of all life, including humans, into a whole. All living and non-living things would make up some kind of superorganism called Galaxia. This was his way to ensure that humanity would be protected by changing humanity into something more easily protected. His view of humanity as a tapestry leads ultimately to want to intertwine all living people in the galaxy into a group consciousness. The two back-to-back novels are thus, in a sense, the beginning and the end of a long journey for him. Robots and Empire is very different from the other robot novels, and indeed is only considered a part of it because the characters here appeared in the previous novel. Still, it's an interesting work. A few of the Asimov holds a conversation with himself scenes are probably unneeded, but otherwise it's a different kind of mystery and puts a great deal of emphasis on relationships. The Daniel Giscard parts are the heart of it, in more ways than one, and the reader starts to feel the sadness that Daniel cannot over the loss of his friend. Whatever one thinks of Asimov's decision regarding the robot and the Foundation stories, the book itself is quite good, and I'd say the only drop ball here is that he chose to deal with the Salarians in Foundation and Earth, despite Giscard's dying instruction to Daniel to learn about what happened. I mean, maybe he did, but with that ending, it seemed the wrong way to resolve the matter. But that's more of a flaw of Foundation and Earth than Robots and Empire.